somebody has to be at the end, so it's not a problem. Somebody has to be last, somebody has to be first. But I request that I get little 5 minutes of extra time as a compensation for that. So it's again a great evening in Chennai. The weather very rarely gets this good in Chennai. And all of us have been, it's again a great pleasure that we have been always in accommodations in Chennai. Like even in this good weather, we still have a lot of people with august audience, and I'm honored to speak here as a speaker. Now let me just see how the process has actually been evolved. The laparoscopy has been something which is not new. It has been in Europe since about 1990, when it was mainly used for diagnostic usage, but little did we know that the person who initially did a cystoscope into the dog's abdomen was actually had to change his practice into a different hospital, because the hospital did not encourage him to continue with his laparoscopic skills there. And that's how it actually evolved. And the gynecologists were the first who had to venture into the field of laparoscopy. And the urologists had been a little lazy at that point of time, so they had to pick it up late in the 1990s and 2000s. And the first application of proven nephrectomy was actually done as late as 1993. And after that, we have been growing in great strides. Like currently, gynecology and urology have been the biggest usage of the minimally invasive platform of laparoscopy and robotics. Now for want of time, laparoscopy is a specialty in itself. I'll be covering only about laparoscopy. I will not touch upon robotics. And at the same time, I'll be restricting myself to speak only on those which have been approved by the European and the American associations. There have been case reports of a lot of other things which have actually been done in the individual centers. Let us not focus on that. Let's approve. Speak only on, look at only on those things which have been actually approved. Now, if gold standard is actually open surgery, then why laparoscopy? It's because it duplicates the open surgery and it reduces the mortality and reduces blood loss, faster recovery, and the least important is actually the last process. Now, let me just take through one, we have only very limited organs to choose, so let me just take through about what we can do minimally invasive in all of these organs. Like we can see here, one of the adrenal tumors here, the suprarenal on the right side. The indications, as we all know, now this can be done laparoscopically with three simple trocars. And the outcomes are actually excellent. Even pheochromocytomas can be managed by minimally invasive laparoscopic surgery. I have not included any videos. I'll be showing representative steps to demonstrate how it duplicates the open surgery. Now if you see the kidney, the standard procedures have been laparoscopic radical nephrectomies, the simple nephrectomies and the donors. And the state of art surgeries will be laparoscopic partials, laparoscopic cryotherapy and laparoscopic anatrophic nephrodotomies. Now let's go to the live donor nephrectomy. The bowel preparations are no longer mandatory as against the open surgeries, but the Foley catheter is mandatory. Right tube during the procedure is actually mandatory. And DBT prophylaxis is only for those high-risk cases as against the open surgeries. And we restrict antibiotics to only two doses, one given pre-op and the other given at 6 hours after the procedure. There is no need for any more antibiotics. Now if you see here, this is the representative case of a person who has presented with double ringlactomy on the left side, single ringlactomy on the right side. Either side can be done laparoscopically as far as donor surgery. And this is the position which is actually given, the Trendelenburg, the lateral positions. And as against the open surgery, in a laparoscopic surgery, the patient will be, you will be facing the tummy of the patient and the patient will be towards the opposite edge of the table. Now this is the patient position which is actually given. And these are the position side marks of the trocars, three trocars which will be introduced. And the folds will be placed under vision. And here we can see the white line of folds which is actually very clearly visible here. And idea is to get retroperitoneal. This can be done either cold or sharp dissection. And after that, once we see the ureter here, the ureter will be lifted up from the psoas, which remains here. Here we can see the ureter along with the gonadal, which has been lifted up. This is a psoas muscle. And after that, we go cranially, leave behind the hilum, and then we go and separate the spleen from the upper pole of the kidney and the adrenal. Initially, the adrenal is left along with the specimen. And here we can see the exposure of the renal vein. This is the adrenal vein. And next, after that, we have to cut the adrenal vein. And then we get into a plane between the adrenal and the kidney. Here we can see very clearly the upper pole is completely freed here and the psoas muscle is exposed on top of the kidney. Once this is done, we have to come back bodily again where we can see this is the aorta and these are the lumbar veins. One is already cut. This is second lumbar vein. Care should be taken because only reported deaths of donor surgery has been from troublesome bleeding of the lumbar vein. So due caution must be exercised at this point. Now here, after this, we can see the renal vein and the renal artery. And another artery, which is not shown here, is behind this renal vein. So in this way, the donor surgery can be done at without any minimal risk. And as against the open surgery, it is done with a very small incision. I can show you this scar where it is given. This is like for representative image, I have shown the endovascular stapler. But this is not always mandatory. We can do something with the wet clips. Although FDA gives a black box warning against the usage of wet clips, but these are the only standard clips. The metal clips cannot withstand such high pressures. So the wet clips are the order of the day. These are to be introduced. And it is sad state of affairs that it is because of the market-driven endovascular stapler-driven industry that they have issued a black box warning against the usage of wet clips. And this is the small incision, transitional incision through which the kidney is retrieved. The warm ischemia times are comparable, and this is the final length of the vein which we can achieve laparoscopically. It is as good as the open surgery, and this is the final prosthesis where the length of the incision is as small as 8 to 9 centimeters. And the postoperative renal function, the recipient, at the end of 1 year, the functions are comparable whether you retrieve the kidney in an open surgery or whether you retrieve it laparoscopically. And the graft survivals have also been equally good, and the difference which is observed at the end of 1 year is actually not very minuscule and it's not significant. Now coming to the donor nephrectomy is not the first surgery to do, but that is where the claims are understood much better, and that's why I've showed it at the beginning. And the simple nephrectomy, so many non-functional kidneys, these are all the different indications. I will not go into it. The procedures are actually exactly replicates what I've shown just now. But one thing which needs to be understood is these are the order of cases where we have to select. We cannot just straightforward just rush in and do whatever we get. And for you to achieve your learning curve, initially it will be the simple nephrectomies like the non-functioning kidney secondary to pleurotic junction obstruction where there's not much of infections. And those where you have had some infection that has to be done after the later part of your learning curve. And excipient kidneys have to be dealt with to the last because it will give you a scare of your life. Now, whether can we do bilateral pre-transplant nephrectomies? Yes, it can be done in a single setting where we can see the simultaneous, the procedures are just the same for left and right side except that the IVC needs to be taken care of on the right side and due care should be exercised while effecting cauterization of the duodenum. This can be done laparoscopically. And here we see both the sides, the ureters have been lifted. These are the psoas muscles. This is the left side and this is the right side. Now this is the ADPKD. The indications are listed here and it's known to all of us. And sizes as big as around say 17 centimeters can be retrieved laparoscopically. And this is the final picture where a small incision can be placed in the infra-umbilical region through which the specimen can be retrieved. The idea is to avoid placing an incision on the right side iliac fossa, which will be the further placement of the graft whenever he goes in for transplant. Now whether for malignancy, yes, both all three, radical nephrectomy, partial nephrectomies and nephroureterectomies, all can be done laparoscopically. Now this is a case where about 7 cm renal mass, where, and this is a representative case on the right side. Here is the renal mass, which is T3 disease because it is extending into the hilum, hence we have to resort to a radical nephrectomy here. And the steps are just the same. And as regards to partial nephrectomy, it requires mandates the usage of intraoperative ultrasound where it needs to be visualized so that you can clearly mark the kidney, the tumor, and it involves end block control securing of the hilum with a certain skin clamp introduced by a special port which requires 15mm port. And once this is done, then you have to score out the kidneys after marking through the ultrasound lab. Ultrasound, you have to score out the tumor, and here we can see another tumor here, and we need to score out the tumor like this. And after clamping the vessel, we have to excise and then we have to suture the pelvic adhesion system separately and then buttressing sutures over the cortex, and all this can be done laparoscopically. This is one procedure where a robot has an advantage as compared to a laparoscopic surgery, but simple cases, we use some scoring systems, and simple cases which have a scoring systems of less than 10 can be dealt with laparoscopically, and more complex cases will require the usage of robotic platform. Now here we can see the surgery cell bolster is being placed before taking the buttressing sutures. The parenchyma will be hemostatic after this, and we have to remove the clamp, and then if required, further sutures have to be placed. And this is a special bag. This bag is actually low cost bag, which was designed by the institute where I studied from. It's called a study art bag. And this is made out of just polythene paper and a urethane catheter. So it's a low cost bag. It has already been published in the urological forums and it is also available for in the market for usage. Now coming to nephrourethrectomy, whether can we go down up to the middle part? This is a TCC upper transitional cell carcinoma. There's no bladder involvement, which mandates the removal of the entire ureter. And the same can be done laparoscopically. The kidney part will be the same. After this, the patient needs to be given a second prandial position. The position of the patient needs to be changed, and after which it can be done with one extra port, as shown here. This extra port will be placed, and the surgeon will come and initiate the surgeon will be standing here. And while removing the lower part of the ureter, the surgeon has to go towards the hiatus of the patient, and this becomes the camera port, and these two ports will be used as working ports, and this ureter can be removed laparoscopically. Here we can see the entire length of the ureter, which is removed up to the level of the bladder. Now, anatomic nephrectomy, yes, but with the advent of PCMLs, the requirement of this procedure has actually gone down. However big the stone is, it actually can be dealt with percutaneous nephrectomy. But some very large, very hard stones in a sort of borderline functioning kidneys, it is a procedure which can be done. Now coming to pyeloplasties, the procedure step will be the same. I'll just go through the images. These are the port positions as against the destructive surgery like nephrectomy. Mandates the placement of a straight line port, which is more ergonomic. And here the golden review mobilized. Here we can see the pelvis which is exposed. And it can be done transmesocolic as well in a favorable patient, where the base of mesentery appears to be thinner. In those patients, it can be done transmesentrically. And head stitch, it involves the placement of head stitch. This is a crossing vessel, which is the reason why it has got a POJO. This can be saved. And here it involves dismembering and then suturing to the healthy ureter. If you have a long segment ureter, it still again can be managed with the flap pyeloplasty, which involves the pylotomy and then raising of the pelvic flap. And this flap will be brought down and it will be sutured to the healthy part. Now the end result is as against it duplicates the open counterpart, it has to be watertight, depending on the basic principles have to be the same, otherwise the procedure will not be helpful. Now regarding the reconstructions, coming down, lower down, ureteroureterostomies, Bowery reconstructions, both can be done laparoscopically, but I am not resorting to the ideal replacement of the entire ureter because that is still not approved to be done laparoscopically. But yes, technically it is doable, but I restrict myself to only those that have been approved by the universities. Here we can see the RGB which is showing the ureteric strictures. Here we can see the balloon cloud upper system, and here the structure is region. And here we can see the cut end, and we can see the good amount of urine jet which is coming out, which is being filled. And it involves placement of vital sutures, anastomosing both the healthy ends. Now coming to lower trunk, whether cystectomy can be done, yes, it can be done both partial and radical, but proper case selection is important because this is one procedure which has a postoperative mortality rate of as close to 10%, and we have to be very careful in a patient who has a good general condition. We have to resort to all these minimally invasive procedures. No procedure is without any undue risk, so it has to be, the case selection has to be proper. And if we can see here, this is a small mass which is presenting at the dome of the bladder. The clinical suspicion was for an adenocarcinoma of the bladder. A cystoscopy and a biopsy was done, after which we decided to resort to the partial cystectomy. And this is what was done here. You can see the mass there at the dome of the bladder. And here we involve just bringing down the bladder from the anterior abdominal wall, getting into the ischial space. And after that, you score out the mass completely under cystoscopic visualization. The cystotomy is made away from the tumor. And here we can see the mass, and with maintaining a good amount of margin, we can just score across the tumor completely. And this can be removed in a bag immediately. And here we can see the Foley and the rest of the bladder. And sutures can be done to close the cystotomy. And a check is done to make sure that there is no leak. Now coming to radical cystectomy, yes, the dissection part is the same. Only thing is that radical cystectomy entails a posterior dissection to be done first. Here we can see this is the bladder, and here will be the rectum. We get inside this both of Douglas here, and posterolateral dissection coming up to the bladder pedicles. And after that, the posterior pedicle will be controlled with bed clips or with staplers. And then after that, anterior dissection is done up to the level of dorsal vein. And here we can see the dorsal vein being controlled. And after that, a lymph node dissection can also be done laparoscopically. So it involves a huge amount of work to be done. Cystectomy is not an easy surgery. It involves the due amount of time which you have to invest because an open cystectomy, a good open surgeon can finish it off in 3 to 4 hours time, as against a laparoscopy or a robotic surgery which mandates the requirement of around say an extra hour of surgery. So due caution should be exercised only in those patients who have good general condition. We currently advocate for this procedure. Now coming to laparoscopic prostate, here we can see that only difference is that we have to do the anterior part first. Here we can see the anterior resection, the space of Ritzius. Here we can see the dorsal vein complex, and here we can see the bladder which is being incised. And after that, we incise the posterior wall of the bladder to go to the vas deferens here. And after that, it's the rectum beneath here. So we need to maintain a good amount of plane here. After which, the posterolateral pedicles are controlled, and the vesicoureteral anastomosis is done, anastomosing the urethra to the bladder. This is a very complicating surgery as far as laparoscopy, because the pelvic confines are making it a little difficult. It is doable, but this is another surgery where the robot has a clear-cut advantage as against a laparoscopy. But yes, it can be done. Now, these three lines are not empty lines, because only to say that where are we now and where can we be and where can we definitely going to be. Now, what I mean to say is that there are future, like these are surgeries which are being done. I have not mentioned a few surgeries which are already done by a sort of a case series in particular institutes who have got great amount of experience. Like for example, LESS and MOTES. These have not been picked up by all the institutes because it has been a little cumbersome to actually do those procedures because of, you know, clashing of the instruments. And it is actually not making, because a single incision which is being given ultimately turns out to have the same amount of length as against a different site port instruments. So this is something which is actually not picked up, but the Da Vinci has, the robotic platform is actually coming out with a single incision, single port Da Vinci instruments. And that's again making the situations a little more complex. But as far as laparoscopy is concerned, this is something for the future. This is still not being widely done in majority of the institutes. And again, the notes, it's still not being done in majority of institutes. There have been case reports where the donor kidney has been retrieved via the vagina in a female patient, and via the partial nephrectomies have been done by instruments which have been introduced through the transgastric route. But that's something for the future, because we don't know how much contamination that's going to cause, and the long-term results we don't know. So that's something which is not being advocated currently. Now, computer access surgery. Here we use artificial intelligence, where the imaging is actually fed into the patient's live surgery, where the artificial intelligence, the imaging actually is seen live in a three-dimensional model, just recording to the CT scans. And the surgeon has to just follow what the computer access system is actually telling him. But that's something which has been under investigations. This is definite to come out in the future, but this is still not being widely available. The cost is a different constraint, but whether should we listen to a machine which is actually letting you do a particular, guiding you through a particular step, or should you use your conscience and your experience in doing, is the biggest question which remains to be answered. Now, whatever we learn, the skill has to be imparted to the next sort of junior people or this other generation. So that's where the skill transfer comes. And as against the open surgery, where what say two or three people can have the chance to get assisting the major or main operating surgeon, laparoscopy, the skill transfer is much more easier. That's because you have magnification, everything can be seen in a monitor, and even the last, the first year, the last resident can still see the procedure from a distance. So he gets an actual tissue feel of how, what the planes are and how it is going to be. So to some extent, there have been head-on studies between open surgery skill transfer and laparoscopic surgery skill transfer, and it has been seen that laparoscopic surgery, the learning curve is much shorter for those people who have actually been exposed to a lot of surgeries. So it's not just, the health study principle does not hold true here. It's not just learning by doing, it's also learning by seeing in laparoscopy. And that's the biggest advantage which we feel. The skill transfer to the next generation is going to be much, much easier. And we have something called as gold score. I'm not going into the details. And now coming to what lies in future, like these are things, computer access surgeries and all things are actually coming for the future. And there have been few, few institutes which have started doing robotic recipient surgeries. And whether it is actually going to be the future or not, we don't know. Only time remains to be seen. But these are few PubMed indexed few articles where which have actually been the laparoscopy and robotic assisted techniques versus open techniques for kidney transplant recipients, where they have seen the level of evidence was generally low. Minimally invasive techniques showed promising results with regard to complications and recovery and could be considered for use. For open surgery, the smallest possible Gibson incision appeared to yield a favorable result. So this is definitely possible, and in future, who knows, down the lane, 10 years later, the same thing can be presented by some people here in this same August audience. This is again another from the PubMed. Robotic assisted transplant surgery, it's no longer a vision, it is definitely a reality, but it has been limited to few particular institutes which have been doing them, and it is still not part of widespread practice. Now to conclude, the light definitely looks bright at the end of the laparoscope. Most of the procedures in urology seem to be doable by laparoscopy. Only thing that remains to be seen is the risk to the patient. We have to be careful with regard to case selection so that we don't do any harm to the patient. And I conclude by saying this. Thank you so much.
See, just a basic question. You know, the organ, how does it come out with this bore? You know, the laparoscope, the dimension will be, I don't know, the kidney, how does it come out without getting squeezed or when you deliver the organ?
What we actually do is we, in the preoperative CT scan, we get to measure the size of the kidneys. The long length of the kidney is generally varying from 8 to 10 centimeters. And the breadth of the kidney is generally varying from about say 4 to 6 centimeters. So your phalanx steel incision, which you place for a donor retrieval, is going to be 8 to 9 centimeters. So longitudinally, along the aspect of the kidney, it can be easily taken out without any squeeze. We have to hold the perinephric fat and the periuretic fat so that you don't cause any undue damage to the vessels. It has to be taken out without inside the palm of your hand, and you have to introduce your hand and take it out along the longitudinal aspect of the kidney and not the breathways.
And the robotic surgery also includes laparoscopy, or it's completely different?
The principles are the same, sir. Only thing is in laparoscopy, like if you lift your hand, it's going to be counterintuitive. As against a robotic surgery where if you lift your hand in the robotic console, the instrument is, tip of the instrument is also going to come up along with you. This is only one basic difference which you need to understand. Laparoscopy is more difficult to master than a robotic surgery. If you are a good open surgeon, you can easily go into the robotic platform. It was actually a surprise that I met Shamla madam here. She was my examiner when I passed my MS exam. I didn't know she was going to come here. And I graduated from Stanley Medical College under Professor Devan Aigam. And she was one of my teachers. So it's really a great pleasure to actually speak in front of your teacher. The stars are shining bright on me. Thank you so much.
I told Shamla to come and hand out a certificate to see if she's the right person. Professor to student. Yeah.
There can be no greater pressure than for a parent to see the child. So likewise, it's really nice to hear from my student. Excellent, thank you.
So once again, I thank each and every one for your continued support and time. The session comes to an end. We'll meet next month. Thank you.
Not done. I'll have to make it.